Hey everyone, it's the Drive School Podcast. I'm Pastor Goodman. Pastor Schomburger, you're back. How you doing?
I'm doing good. Doing well. Yeah. Happy California summer.
That's not so bad. We're hanging in there right now. And one of the things that you're getting to do a lot of, we're talking about as recordings, you get to teach. You get to teach people who have heard this all their life. You get to teach people who are hearing this sometimes for the very first time, not because they're not Christian, but they're new to Lutheranism. You're getting to talk to some people who are just brand new to this altogether. And so one of my favorite things to dive into with this is to do the thing one of our old professors did to us. Whenever we had asked a question we thought was really, I got you here. He would just look at us and he would go, wrong question. And I used to think that he was just didn't want to answer the question because he couldn't, but he was smarter than me, it turns out, as a shocker, I know. But if you ask the wrong questions, you're never going to get the right answers, right?
Oh, no, absolutely. I was telling you before this that, you know, in a lot of these classes that I have that are people that are new to, you know, Lutheran doctrine and theology, and even the concept that that there's a distinction between law and gospel, or God's commands and his promises, you know, you get these kind of questions all the time as people are, what if? Well, what about that? Well, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah, if is a dangerous one. We should dive into that one another time. But right now, we were kicking around one before. What do I learn next?
Yeah, and that is always the thing, right? Is that we're wanting to get, we're big on next level.
Yeah.
What's
after
the next
confirmation?
Thing?
Yeah, I read the Book of Concord. Now what do I read? Yeah, I've already been through this Bible study. You preach the same sermon every week. Yeah. What do I learn next?
We're ready for 2.0.
Right.
So that's a really good question, because the question is always going to return you back to the first things, the things that you first learned, or as Jesus told, remember Mary and Martha, he says, what is needful was the real answer, which is just to sit and receive from Jesus, instead of doing all this stuff like Martha was. But yeah, I think that's the thing, is that we're always returning to the same things. I think I was telling you this a second ago, how people are always wanting to tell me, well, I already know about how to distinguish the law and the gospel. I don't need to learn that or hear that again, because I learned that. And some of that is because we think that the Bible is just about giving me information, that I'm somehow supposed to, that it's about just making me smarter. And if I was smarter, and I knew the information or had knowledge, then I would progress to the next thing.
Yeah.
Right. And that's the way we think naturally. But the problem is that we're still in sinful flesh. We still have that old Adam rears his ugly head all the time. Mm-hmm. And because of that, we're always going back to first things. We're always going back to the Ten Commandments, going back to the creed, going back to the Lord's Prayer, et cetera, right?
Uh-huh. Right. I mean, there's kind of two motivations, and they're both sinful. So obviously, the first one, when we get this, like we hear the gospel and it's beautifully just simple. Jesus died for you. Your sins are forgiven. He is risen. You'll rise too. That's it. That you're baptized. You are a child of God. And we're like, okay, now what? Because like, I get that. Now, what do I do with that? How do I employ this? And then you try to, and it went terribly. So like, so I did your thing and my life didn't get better. So now what do I do so that my life actually gets better? And both of them are like, there has to be something more to this than just the forgiveness of sins.
Sure. Well, because we're in sinful flesh, that we can't reform that sinner, right? It's not about
like he's drowning every day, but he still keeps popping back up.
But in the Catechism, baptism indicates, what does baptism indicate? Well, that the old Adam has to die every day, all the time, so that the new man can be raised. And so we have death as a daily, constant death and resurrection. I was a couple of weeks ago teaching the large catechism on the Lord's Prayer. And at the end of it, at the end of the prayer, you realize sort of how many times he keeps talking about how we need protection from the devil. We need rescue from our sinful flesh and from this world, our three enemies, constantly. And one of them was that he goes back to a lot is because the devil never sleeps. He doesn't stop. And the same is true with our sinful flesh. It's not like it says, okay, I'm done. You won. But it's always trying to, you know, take God's gifts and turn them into something I do. So going back to what's next, well, everything that's next flows from the first things. Maybe to answer your question differently. The good works that I want to do and I should do only come as good from God. That's what it means to be good. No one is good but God. And so how does he give them? Well, he gives me to do them, and I only can do them in faith because he's made me righteous.
Sure.
And so now I'm free. I don't have to love and serve my neighbor in order to earn something from God.
No bait and switch.
Yeah. But instead, I want to love and serve my neighbor because I'm free now to do so. He's freed me, and I can't help but do it. What does a good tree do? It bears good fruit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So yeah, the fruit that we want to make happen is that which the Lord produces in us through the means of grace or the gospel.
Right. So it's actually going to do its thing all by itself. And we return back then to see the tree pruned. We go back then with our sins to receive more forgiveness from Jesus, but he continues to pour out good in us. And so we can see it practically there. I think the other place where we start to do it is, as like you said, I already learned this in catechism, Pastor. Why are we still talking about law and gospel? I read the catechism. I even read the large one. What do I learn next?
Right. Well, Luther, for example, on baptism, Luther says there's enough in just baptism for us to unpack the rest of our lives. It's kind of like, you know, that baby who is baptized has zero idea all the things it's getting, and neither does the grown-up pastor who was baptized, right? We're always going, wow, look at what you did, are doing, and will continue to do through this great gift. And that's, you know, that's our certainty. It's not in these good works that the Lord does prepare for me to walk in, but he doesn't have us look to those things even though they're good, but they're good because he's good and he gives them to us as a gift. Instead, we look to the one who's the author and the finisher of our faith.
Right. So you're looking for a more complex God. And honestly, yeah, his thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. There are parts of God that you will always never, ever, ever understand. But there are also the parts that he wants you to know are the beautifully simple ones. And the more you study them, the more you learn. This is actually what's wonderful. So I'm a big fan of the historic, the one-year lectionary, which means every single year you have the same exact reading that you had the year before. And I love it because, like, first you can, like, steal way more sermons from old dead guys who are brilliant and, like, just come up with what you got to say there. But also because, like, every time I return to the text, I've learned something since then. And if I haven't, that usually means I need to. The more you dive into the scriptures, the deeper they seem to want to go.
Yeah, same is true for me. And it'll be true for all of us, right? An example for me is how many times just this past year I've taught the catechism to different groups of people, different classes, young, old, whoever. Some that kind of knew something about the catechism, some who had no clue, to a group of lifelong members on Thursday nights. They still are doing the large catechisms, the same teaching.
Love that.
But you know what we're doing again and again, every time I'm preparing, every time I'm looking at it, I'm blown away at connections I'm finding that I'm like, I just read this last week. I just taught this last Sunday. And so in Bible class, we taught we're teaching the Augsburg Confession, and it was on the Lord's Supper. So I went through the small catechism on the Lord's Supper, and I found all kinds of things that I'm like, man, I never picked up on this whole focus on these words. And this return to these words. And just how it is with whatever you're reading, the Bible's this way, right? The Word of God is living and active because God's there with it and he's giving gifts. He's enlightening through the Holy Spirit. That's what the, you know, the Catechism confesses, we say when we say, I believe in the Holy Spirit. So yeah, there's always new stuff because we always have to be returned to this life of repentance, this daily mm-hmm. life of being put to death and made alive.
Right, which almost kind of leads into the last way that we sort of want to address this. What do we learn next? There's this Luther quote that's very, very famous that you need to hear the gospel every day because you forget it every day. So what do you learn next? Well, you relearn the thing that you forgot, right?
Oh, no, absolutely. And the thing that you're like, oh, yeah. How soon we are to forget. Well, think about it. Even right after church, right? You go or maybe if you went to a Higher Things conference, you had this fantastic week. And then on your drive home, you're like, you know, oh, yeah, I forgot that because you go somewhere really weird in your head or you experience something awful. And you're like, I was just blessed. And I just, you know, cussed and tried to run three people off the road on the way home from church or something. But yeah, no, we're always doing that. We're always returning to those same things.
Yeah. See me, I return to the law like a dog returns to his vomit. I every time I know Jesus died for me and I'm saved by grace through faith, but like, how do I get better? How like actually get better? Like, I know that like, I'm literally so good that I can't die anymore, but how do I get better? And I know that like, I'm as holy as Yahweh himself because he has washed me clean in his water. But like, how do I get away from doing dumb stuff? I run back to the law and in the midst of like always trying to outrun anxiety and chase down self-improvement, I need to hear the gospel again.
Yeah.
You are already enough. You are already baptized. You are forgiven. You don't fix this. You die. And then you rise again.
Well, and the third article of the creed is so helpful in this because I love the part where it tells us that in this Christian church, in the church, the reason that we have a church is because there, that's the location where our sins are daily and richly forgiven. And it's for me and for all believers, because there the Holy Spirit is at work through the word and sacraments to do exactly what you're talking about, to put to death those old things, because they are with Christ. And he put them away. They're as far as the east is from the west, removed from you, because Jesus bore them in his own body on a cross. And they're with him when he was in the tomb, but he rose again. He came out of the tomb. And his resurrection now is the certainty of yours and is the rising of the new man for you.
Brilliant. It's really calls to light what the church is. I forget who said it originally, but Christianity is not a place for the good people to get better. Christianity, the church is a place where the dying go to die with Christ and rise. So the wrong question is, what do I learn next? But then what's maybe the right question?
I think the right question would be, what is most needful? It's really the question that Jesus asks, is asking Martha when she's busy trying to do the stuff, get to the next level. And he says that Mary's doing the needful thing. So what is that? It's always this returning to receiving all these things from the Lord, everything I need, right? For not only this temporal life, right? Mm-hmm. Daily bread, all that, but also for the life to come, for eternity, to be kept in the faith. That's what he gives, all of it. There's nothing that I have that hasn't been received, and to be a sinner means to deny that and to say, I'll do it, I got it, hey, I got this. But it's that's what we return to. So maybe the question is what is most needful for me to do?
Yeah, here, receive. I love it. Pastor, thanks so much.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, we'll do it again soon.
Sounds good.